Christopher West is best known as the popularizer and teacher of St. John Paul II's Theology of the Body. He is an internationally renowned speaker and best-selling author and has taught graduate and undergraduate courses on the subject since the 1990s. Some of these places include St. John Vianney Theological Seminary in Denver, the Institute for Priestly Formation in Omaha, and as a visiting professor of the St. John Paul II Institute in Melbourne, Australia. He is the founder and president of the CORE Project, which empowers men and women to dive into the fullness of God's divine plan. Christopher spoke at AMU in 2015 and was here again to speak to students on freedom to love. It was such an honor for me to sit down with Christopher. He proclaims truth with so much passion and love, as you will see in just a few moments. Christopher and his teachings inspire and empower me never to settle. He speaks to the truth of the reality of our hearts. We long for so much more. Christopher's teaching shows it is possible to find fulfillment in God through studying the theology of the body, to satisfy the burning desire in our soul for something out of this world. We'll be right back with Christopher West. Hi, welcome to Face to Face. I'm Annie Schlueter, and we're here at Ave Maria University with Christopher West. Thank you for joining us, Christopher.
You're welcome, Annie. Great to be with you and your audience.
So your name has become basically the same thing as Theology of the Body. How did your passion for Theology of the Body start?
Well, I wouldn't want to supplant the name of St. John Paul II. So my name has been connected because I've been popularizing the Pope's teaching for over 20 years. I first discovered John Paul II's Theology of the Body in 1993. I was 24 years old, and it was the first time that somebody put a name to the deep ache that I felt in my heart my whole life. He said, that ache I have is called Eros, E-R-O-S. And this was a shock to me, because I grew up in the Catholic Church in the 70s and 80s, and nobody was talking about Eros. If it ever came up, it was like, that's bad, that's dirty, you got to repress all that, but follow all the rules and you'll be a good upstanding Christian citizen. Well, I call that the starvation diet gospel. You know, there's a hunger we all have. We're all looking for love, we're all looking for life. And if Christianity is presented to us as a starvation diet, well, I don't know about you, but I'm going for the fast food that the culture's offering, right? The culture's offering this promise of immediate gratification of those hungers. When I discovered John Paul's Theology of the Body, it was the first time somebody said, there's a banquet that corresponds with that hunger. I had been burned by the starvation diet. I got even more burned by the fast food. And so this message was life-changing to me. I knew then that I was holding in my hands the answer to the crisis of our times. I really felt like I had discovered something as big as the cure for cancer or something like that. And I knew I would spend the rest of my life studying this teaching and sharing it with the world. That was the early 90s. I ended up studying at the Pontifical Institute for Studies on Marriage and Family, where John Paul II himself had established this school to promote this teaching. I knew that's where I would study for my graduate work, and then I was hired by the Archdiocese of Denver to revamp their marriage prep programs, and my speaking and teaching and writing took off from there.
That's so beautiful. So in your speaking and teaching and writing, you talk about a personal encounter with Jesus Christ, this personal relationship relating to Theology of the Body. What does that look like and how does it relate?
Yeah, I love to say that we can summarize the whole Bible with five words. And here they are. God wants to marry us. The ache we feel for love, for union, is a yearning for heaven. It's a yearning for something infinite. It's what the scripture describes as the marriage of the Lamb. Christ is that Lamb. And he came into the world, took on flesh as a bridegroom to give up his body for his bride, the church, so that we could become one with him, with the divine forever. The ache we feel, Eros, properly called Eros, E-R-O-S. We hear that word Eros and we confuse it with another Greek word, porneia, right? So we know where porneia goes, right? Porneia is a distortion of Eros. I like this as an image. I like to say God gave us eros, to be like the fuel of a rocket that has the power to launch us to the stars, to infinity and
beyond.
Right, exactly. But here's the tragedy of original sin. Those rocket engines became inverted. And this is why we go out in life, we're seeking love, we're seeking happiness, we're seeking fulfillment, and so often it backfires on us. This personal relationship we're called to have with Jesus is this. He comes into the world not to condemn those with inverted rocket engines. And I'm exhibit A here when it comes to inverted rocket engines. He comes into the world to redirect our rocket engines to the stars so that we can launch and not crash and burn. There is a fulfillment that corresponds to the hunger. This personal relationship with Jesus is, well, the saints describe it as a spousal intimacy. The scripture uses marriage as its main image from beginning to end to tell us who God is. The Bible begins with the marriage of man and woman. Throughout the Old Testament, God speaks of his love for his people as the love of a husband for his bride. In the New Testament, the love of the eternal bridegroom is literally embodied when the word is made flesh. Skip to the end of the story, the book of Revelation describes heaven as an eternal marriage, the marriage of God and us. When you look to those two bookends of the Bible, begins with the marriage of man and woman, ends with the marriage of Christ and the church, we have the key now for understanding the whole story. God wants to marry us, and he wanted this eternal marital plan to be so plain to us that he stamped an image of it right in our bodies by making us male and female and calling the two to that intimate embrace. But see, the reason we're so confused in our world today about the meaning of marriage, about the meaning of gender, about the meaning of sexuality, is because there's an enemy who's gotten in the mix, who doesn't want us to reach heaven, doesn't want us to reach that eternal marriage. So what does he attack? He attacks the sign of it, which is our humanity as male and female. Because if he can twist and scramble what John Paul II calls the language of our bodies, we're not going to know that our body has a message from God anymore. We're not going to know that the love of husband and wife is meant to launch us to heaven. We live in a world today, Annie, where the basic message is your body means nothing. Your body is meaningless. Well, Christianity says, no, no, your body reveals ultimate meaning. Because God himself took on a body to reveal the ultimate meaning of everything, which is love. And that love is revealed not in some spiritual kind of phantom way, but through the flesh, through our bodies, through our sexuality. The call to love, as God loves, is literally chiseled by God in the sexual difference. We could put it this way. God's love is generous. It generates. And that's why he made us gendered human beings, to image his generous, generating love. In the normal course of events, the union of the two leads to a third. And here we catch a little glimpse, John Paul tells us, a little glimpse of Trinitarian love and communion. Your body and my body, every body, it's not just biological, it's theological, because it tells God's story. It's astounding. It's a life changer if we really let it sink in.
Definitely. So with this attack on the body that we're discussing, is that something that's new?
No. No, the attack on the body goes way back to the beginning. There's always been an enemy who's come into the mix and tried to scramble the message of the body. In fact, we read it right in Genesis that the enemy's hatred, his enmity, is aimed in a very particular way at human fertility. Why? Well, we read in scripture that Lucifer, right? Lucifer was created a good angel. Everything God made is good, right? But Lucifer, angel of light, that's what it means, he fell out of envy. Envy. What does he envy? Well, what do we have as human beings that the angels don't have?
Bodies.
Bodies, right? So the angels, we have the good angels and we have the fallen angels, right? So the angels will either be in awe of the human body. Think of Gabriel when he comes to Mary. He's in awe of Mary's fertility, because her fertility is about to do what?
Save humanity.
Yes, her fertility is about to bring God to planet Earth in the flesh. That is the astounding glory of woman's body, right? If Christianity is real, if Christmas is real, then woman's body has become heaven on earth. Mm. What is heaven? It's the dwelling place of the Most High God. What happened to Mary? Her body became the dwelling place of the Most High God. And this is why the enemy is after, in a particular way, woman and her fertility. It says right in Genesis, his enmity, his hatred, is aimed at the woman's ability to bear offspring. Because it's the woman's offspring that will bring God to planet Earth, right? And here we are, Revelations 12, to skip ahead from Genesis to Revelation. So the whole Bible tells the story of the attack against the body and the attack against fertility. Revelations 12, what does the great dragon want to do before the pregnant woman? He wants to devour her child, right? If we want to know what an abortion clinic is, turn the lights on, that's what it is. We're not saying this to wag fingers, scold, shame, or condemn anybody. We're saying it to turn the lights on, to recognize we're in a war. St. Paul talks about it. Ephesians chapter 5, which John Paul II calls a summary of the whole Bible. St. Paul quotes from the beginning of the Bible and then links it to the marriage of Christ and the church, the end of the Bible, when he says, "For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother, be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh." That's right out of the book of Genesis. And then he adds, "This is a great mystery, and it refers to Christ and the church." Do you know what this means? Human sexuality, if we have the eyes to see it right, it's all about Jesus. Mm. It's meant to reveal God's eternal plan to marry us, to be one with us in the flesh. That's what human sexuality is all about. Where does this happen? Where does Christ become one flesh with us? Eucharist. This is where the bridegroom says to his bride, "This is my body given for you." When we receive Christ into our bodies, if this is real, we conceive eternal life. That's what happens. Like a bride, we conceive eternal life. But there's an enemy who doesn't want us to know any of this. And St. Paul knows it. He says right in the next chapter, in Ephesians chapter 6, he says, "You want to live what I was just telling you about in Ephesians 5? Get ready for a war. A spiritual battle." And he says, you got to put on the armor of God if you're going to live this out. And the first piece of armor that we're called to put on is to gird our loins with the truth. Mm. Are our loins girded in truth, or are they girded in latex? It's not latex that's going to set us free. It's the truth that's going to set us free. Mm.
Amen. Amen. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back here at Ave with Christopher West. Welcome back to Face to Face. I'm Annie Schlueter here at Ave with Christopher West. So Christopher, what do you think is the biggest theology of the body related struggle for Catholic college students today?
Wow, wow. I would say, where are you taking your hunger, right? So we don't even understand what sin is unless we first understand the purpose of our desires, right? Desire has a trajectory. It will take us wherever we aim it, right? The question is, are we aiming our desire for fulfillment at that which truly fulfills, right? I love Pope Benedict XVI's insights on this question. He says, when we don't understand the fulfillment to which we're called in Christ, we will aim our desires at what he calls false infinities. What does that mean? Well, all the pleasures of the created world, who made them?
God.
God. God made all the pleasures of the created world. I don't know about you. I love to eat. I love to eat. In fact, at the end of a good meal, I'm sad. Why am I sad? Well, because it's over, right? The joy of eating is done. It's over. Right in that sadness, I have three choices. I can pretend I don't feel the sadness and repress it and be a stoic, right? or I can go back for more food than my body needs, and I could become then an addict, indulging in disordered ways in the pleasures of this world. Or I can become an aspiring mystic. What do I mean by that? The mystic sees everything in the world as a sign of eternity. And at the end of that meal, when I'm sad, that sadness is proof to me that I'm meant for a feast that never ends, right? So what do I do with my desire? I should thank God for the gift of that meal and the deliciousness of the meal, the joy of eating that meal, but I should recognize this meal is not what I'm ultimately made for, but it is meant to be a little glimmer of what I'm ultimately made for. The Bible describes heaven as a wedding feast. When I aim my desire for infinite satisfaction at something finite, of course it never satisfies. So what do I think I need? More. And if I go and I get more, does it satisfy yet? Nope. So what do I think I need? More, more. Mm-hmm. That's not happiness, that's addiction. Right? So I would say on a college campus, this is a very, very important question. Where are you aiming your desires? Right? If we take a kind of stoic, repressive approach to the pleasures of this world, then every pleasure is going to be seen as evil. That's not Catholicism, that's Puritanism, that's Manichaeism, and all kinds of other isms that are heresies. Catholicism rejoices in the beauty and goodness of the created world, but doesn't expect more from it than it's able to deliver. What are the joys of music? What are the joys of food? What are the joys of sexual love and God's design? All of it is meant to be a sign that points us beyond itself to something infinitely greater. And in this sense, only the aspiring mystic, only the one who is opening his or her yearning for the infinite to the infinite, only that kind of person can rejoice in a good beer without it becoming an addiction. Only that person can rejoice in the pleasures of this world without them becoming so many addictions. Rather, they become so many icons that point us to eternity. I'd say this is probably the main challenge, not just on a college campus, although it's pointedly present on a college campus, but it's the main challenge of every human life. What do I do with my desires? Do I repress them? Do I indulge them in disordered ways? Or do I learn how to open them to the infinite? There's a word for that journey of opening our desires to the infinite. It's called prayer. St. Augustine says that prayer is nothing but a holy longing for God. That's what prayer is.
That's so beautiful.
Yeah.
Wow. So emotional chastity is a term that's come up a lot within recent years. How does emotional chastity relate to theology of the body?
Yeah, I get a little skeptical here in terms of how we're using words. And we need, as John Paul II himself says, we need to rehabilitate the word chastity, right? Chastity, if you were raised like I was raised on what I call the starvation diet, which is basically your desires are bad, you need to repress all that, and here are all the rules to follow. Well, then chastity is going to be considered something entirely repressive. Chastity is not that. Chastity, true chastity, is learning how to redirect our rocket engines towards the stars. That's chastity. Chastity is not repressive, it's liberating, because it's ordering our sexual desires towards the full truth of love. And the full truth of love is not, that's your body and I want it for me. The full truth is the opposite. This is my body and I give it up for you. That's the Christian way, right? Jesus says, love one another as I have loved you. How did he love? By the gift of his body, right? The gift of, this is my body given for you. Chastity is like the discipline that was required of chastity, and it does require discipline. The discipline required is like the discipline of a musician, right? Who needs to discipline his muscles to play the piano in such a way that he can make beautiful music, right? We think of chastity as the piano's evil. Right? Nobody should be playing the piano. It's just bad. No. Chastity is learning to play the piano beautifully. Unchastity is banging on the piano keyboard and making meaningless noise, right? anybody can walk up to a piano keyboard and make meaningless noise. But a concert pianist can also walk up to a piano keyboard and spontaneously make beautiful music that lifts our souls to the heavens. But behind that is chastity, discipline, sacrifice, struggle. But you can't tell me that struggle's not worth it for that beautiful music. See, not everybody is going to be called to be a professional musician. But everyone is called by the gospel, by our very humanity, to be professional lovers, to love in the image of God. And that's going to take discipline. That's going to take training. But it's creative discipline. It leads to something beautiful, like a musician or an athlete. So we have to have that idea of chastity properly understood in order to talk about emotional chastity without emotional chastity becoming something constrictive and repressive. Right? So when I hear emotional chastity, my concern is that we start crushing our emotions, that we start fearfully rejecting our emotions and our feelings. Emotions are an integral aspect of our humanity, and we shouldn't fear them. Do they need to be disciplined? Do they need to be channeled? Do they need to be formed and shaped? Absolutely they do. But in some circles, when I hear emotional chastity, it's framed in such a way that makes you fearful of your emotions. This is not chastity. That's actually a form of lack of chastity. Right? It's a coping mechanism for lack of chastity. Chastity molds and shapes our entire personality, body and soul, emotions, spirit, physicality, sensuality. All of it becomes formed and shaped towards the truth of authentic love. I don't know about you, but if that's real, if it's really, I look at myself, I look at my broken humanity, and the furniture's out of order. I mean, the desires, if I just follow my emotions are fickle. If I just follow my sensual desires, they're gonna lead me towards momentary pleasure, but it's gonna leave a wake of destruction behind me, right? It's gonna hurt me, it's gonna hurt others. Why is it gonna hurt others? Because when sensual pleasure is the name of the game, other human beings become objects for our pleasure. But we know deep in our hearts we're never meant to be used for someone's pleasure. The opposite of love in the language of John Paul II is not so much hatred. The opposite of love is to use a person as a means to my own selfish end. Chastity is the virtue that frees us, he says, from this utilitarian attitude. It frees us to love. It frees us to look upon another person and see a person, not a thing. It helps us to see the body not as something, but as someone. And to treat the body not as something for my pleasure, but as someone who's worthy of love. If chastity is doing that, then we have a proper understanding of it. If chastity is choking us off, if chastity is repressing our feelings and emotions and desires, that's not chastity. The opposite, therefore, of that repression is not indulgence, though. The true virtue is that redirecting of the desires towards the truth of love, the rearranging of the furniture of our heart, so to speak, so that we see something beautiful, so that we learn how to love as we're called to love. And sorry, I got to quote a song from my 20s. I think this was Bryan Adams in the 90s. You know, when you find that love that really honors the dignity of the person, you can't tell me it's not worth fighting for. You can't tell me it's not worth dying for. It is. That kind of love. We're all made for that kind of love. It's worth fighting for. It's worth dying for. That's chastity. If that's what we're talking about, I'm all for it.
Thank you so much, Christopher.
You're welcome,
Annie.
It's been
such an honor to have you here.
It's a pleasure. Real pleasure.
Thanks for joining us for Face to Face. Tune in for one more segment.
Thank you so much for joining us today on Face to Face. The Ave Maria University community is full of individuals who are set on living their lives to the fullest now. I hope that what you watched today encourages you to go out and live boldly. Your life has purpose and meaning. Regardless of where you are called to greatness. Go dive in and meet this world Face to Face. My name is Annie Schlueter, and I'll see you next time on Face to Face.